Hello, I'm Jennifer Hunter. Let's saddle up and ride to Kerrville, Texas, to the Museum of Western Art. Kerrville is a cultural art center with a magnificent museum and a wonderful collection of art and old saddles. I'm honored to have been invited to show my historical and Western paintings as the June Artist of the Month in a solo show at the Museum of Western Art. The show will open on June 1st. It'll hang the entire month, and the reception would be Saturday, June 2nd from 2 to 4 p.m. The museum has a great collection of old Western saddles, similar to the one next to me, that have carried cowboys and cowgirls all over the West. Authenticity is important to represent in Western art, and this is my new old 100-year-old cavalry saddle. It's different from a modern saddle in a lot of ways. It's somewhat narrow, so it doesn't fit a lot of modern horses, like a quarter horse having wide withers probably would not fit in the saddle. It doesn't have metal conchos on it. Back here, this is a leather concho with the leather strings hanging here. It's got a high back cantle, and in the 1800s, your navigation was the stars and a compass. So on the back of that cantle, back here, is a pocket with a flap that covers to keep your compass in. A saddle like this was sold in the Montgomery Ward's catalog from 1890 to 1920. This one is stamped underneath. Right here is the maker's mark. And you'll also notice in this saddle, there are no buckles. If you need to adjust the stirrup on here and adjust the fender length, you have to lace it here with leather and relace it. And the way this fender looks, and it has this strap on top of the fender, that's kind of typical for a saddle in the 1800s. This would be a headstall from the same time period. And this is kind of different than a modern headstall too. You'll notice it does not have any buckles on the side here, except, you know, here's the throat latch buckle. So the only buckle adjustment for the length of this and putting it on your horse is up here, which buckles behind the horse's ears. And it's got nice tooling, nice and wide. It has a nose band, which we don't really see on Western bridles. Everything is tied in with leather. If I compare this to a modern headstall, which there is one right here, and this modern headstall, you'll notice that it's got silver on it, but you'll notice the buckle here for adjustment on the side, and then this is a little screw. So that screws in and holds your bit, and the reins also are screwing on there. I just had to try this new saddle out on my horse. I had a hunch it would fit him, and it did. And so we rode in this, and it was a lot of fun.
you'll wear this too.
I've always loved horses, and many of them have galloped their way into my artwork. And that's probably why I love doing historical paintings so much, because it gives me a chance to, in a sense, go back in time and experience what it was like in the Old West. If you can't do that for real, the best thing that you can do, next best thing, would be to talk to people who know from personal experience the history of the Old West, or people who are reenactors and who can reenact a scene for you and let you get the feel of the Old West. That's what I really hope to do in my artwork, is give my viewers a sense that they are actually there in that place and time, experiencing whatever they're seeing in that painting. There's many stories waiting to be told about the West. The best way I can do that is through my artwork. So I will show you now some of the stories of the West. A cowboy would saddle his horse. When he's on his horse and he had thrown his rope, he would then collect his lariat, gathering his rope. He might need to gather some horses. He always had a favorite horse. There were long days in the saddle driving longhorn cattle up the cattle trails. If you didn't travel by horseback or wagon and just wanted to buy a ticket for passage, maybe you would take a stagecoach. You may need to cross a river, and there were not a lot of bridges. So the stage designed to cross the shallow western rivers was known as a mud wagon. It had a canvas cover and was smaller and lighter than the Concord stage that was used in the east because of the need to navigate the rivers. A heavy wooden stagecoach would just get stuck in the mud, endangering the passengers. There could be all kinds of weather, and a river provided a good way to escape the summer heat. The frontier had been home to many native people of different tribes. The coming of Europeans to the West changed everything and brought horses to North America, where there had been none before. This gave the Indians more mobility and the ability to travel and defend themselves on horseback.
The headdress is held, you know, in a very high reverence, you know.
Yeah.
And those feathers mean a lot of things, you know. They're not just sitting up there because it looks good. And so it's a big thing when you wear it. A guy that would have been wearing you know, the headdress, would have been a leader, would have been the chief, or, you know, leader going into battle, whatever the case. And that would have been because of his accomplishments or his feats, you know, and the fact that people, you know, already recognized and looked at him in that way. And so there's like a confidence, I think, that comes when you're wearing that. And I feel like there's a little something comes over me when I put that on. And I'm, you know, not a chief or a leader to do what we're doing out here, recreate some things so that we can tell stories. I think there should be a confidence in whoever's going to wear that and, you know, wear it like if we were in 1880 and, you know, we were leading. I mean, you know, Crazy Horse, Quanah Parker, these guys were confident men that, you know, I don't think they were second-guessing anything. They were just, they knew what they wanted to do.
As more Europeans settled in the West, the frontier was disappearing. A baby was born in the early 1900s in a teepee, and he would speak the Lakota language and not learn English until he was 6 years old and went to school. He would go on buffalo hunts and grow up to be a rodeo rider, a movie star, and even dance with Marilyn Monroe. And he was a paratrooper wounded in World War II. Later, his people would choose him to be their chief, not just of his tribe, but the leader of all the indigenous tribes of the world.
I was born in a teepee in Cherry Creek, South Dakota, which is about 23 miles down the stream here. In 1919, I was born there.
How old were you when you first rode a horse?
Oh, I was about 6 years old.
Yeah?
And then I joined the rodeo circuit when I was 14 years old.
Wow.
And I used to ride in rodeos, professionally. After I got riding for a while, I joined the professional rodeo circuit. Well, it's a sport that it's a horsemen sport that they get into. Once you get into it, it's a habit. It gets in your blood. And you just want to keep going.
Mm-hmm. I'm honored to have known him as a friend, Chief David Beautiful Bald Eagle. The prospect of gold and rich farmlands attracted settlers to the frontier west. Going west on the Oregon Trail had many challenges, like crossing the Rocky Mountains before winter. With the spring thaw, the streams flowed freely from the higher elevations. Farm life chores included keeping dairy cattle and milking by hand. The family needed milk for their own children, but had to share it with the calves that would be born, so the cow would provide milk. Farmers planted crops, and in the fall, the entire family worked to harvest the grain that would sustain them and their livestock through the winter. Threshing separated the seed from the plant. At first, that chore was done by hand. Later, horses helped thresh the grain with threshing machines. And later yet, coal-fired steam tractors were doing the work of the horses and driving the threshing machines with big leather belts. Covered wagons, pulled by oxen, led the Great Migration into the West. The settlers also brought music to ease their struggles and to keep their spirits up on the long journey. Museum of Western Art is located at 1550 Bandera Highway, Kerrville, Texas, in the beautiful Texas Hill Country. The show will hang from June 1st through June 30th. The reception is on June 2nd, Saturday, from 2 to 4 p.m. If you're going to be in the area, it's worth a visit. Stop in. The museum's website is museumofwesternart.com, and my website, where you can find more information, is jenniferhunter.co. Thank you for watching. Enjoy.
Is it the Texas?
That way.
All right, I guess I better get going. See you there. Let's go, Chester.